stop. Good.
Before we get out in the field, I guess we need to know a little bit about flies.
Okay. Some of the basics about flies. There are basically four groups. You have wet flies, which stay underwater, so they're wet. Dry flies, which sit on top of the water. There are streamers, which imitate fish in the water, very small fish. And then there are terrestrials, which are insects that would drop onto the water from trees and bushes, like grasshoppers, ants, and beetles, things like that. The wet flies basically go through the life cycle in the beginning, where they emerge from under the rock and start working their way up through the water to where they can actually break wings open and fly away. Mm-hmm. The dry flies tend to imitate those insects when they are first coming up off the water, first getting their wings up, starting to stand up to where they can fly away.
It looks like it could fly right off
it
your hand.
It looks like it could fly away, doesn't it? To where they come back down after they have completed their life above the water, and they are actually lying on the water, spent, where their wings would be out beside them, much like an airplane, mm-hmm. lying on the water. Those are called spinners. They also, not only by the way they look, but by size. Fish might just be wanting to go for one particular size that day. They just might only eat that size fly.
Even though there might be flies
that are that size out there, that might be the one they're eating that day. So you want to make sure you have a variety of types of flies and also a variety of sizes.
So do these mimic specific species, or do you just...
Yes, they do.
Okay.
There are a number of variety of mayflies. Mayflies tend to have, they have wings that sit up just like little sails. They have long little tails back there. Caddisflies have wings that sort of tent backwards. And stoneflies have wings that lay flat on their backs, one on top of another like that. Mm-hmm. And so you want to try to imitate them as much as possible. It's good to have a nice variety because you just never know what it is they're going to be wanting that particular day, mm-hmm. that particular hour even. They can change.
So there's a lot of material that goes into mm-hmm. these little things. What different kinds of material are used for tying flies?
You can use... whenever possible, a lot of people are very purist when mm-hmm. it comes to their flies. They want to use all natural materials, and those would include feathers, deer hair, elk hair, feathers from chickens, ducks. I actually know somebody who's actually cut a little hair off his cat when he's been desperate for something. but you can also use artificial good things. You can go to a craft store and find, you know, dyed feather. Marabou and chenille. Chenille makes great bodies for worms and different flies. That's just a little fuzzball. That's all. There's nothing. That imitates eggs. You could definitely find something in your house to help with that.
I have to ask about this little guy. That is so tiny.
He is tiny. But believe it or not, even a fly that small will catch a 20-plus size trout.
Wow.
It definitely will. But even a fly that small,
and
as you can see, I don't even have a barb on this one. I've flattened the barb, so the only point is the point that you see. If you're releasing what you catch, you don't want to release it with badly bleeding or torn up mouth.
Right.
And a barbless hook makes it much, much easier to do that.
And catch and release fishing is really common among trout
fishermen. It has really become very common. At certain times of the year, it's the only way you can fish anyway. And I think I have found that, you know, unless a fisherman is actually planning to just go ahead and camp out and eat, Most of the fishermen I have fished with and have met tend to follow a catch and release pattern.
Mm-hmm. I catch them again another day.
That's right. Let them get a little bigger for the next time.
We found a beautiful day and a nice little stream here for our casting 101 class.
Okay.
Which is important, I think, before we head out to the big river.
Yes. Learn the basic cast and know how to get those fish. Get some line out here to get it going. You want the line to actually go out straight behind you. That's what actually bends the tip. It pulls it down and sort of loads the energy to make it spring back for the forward cast. The most important thing that you can do when fly fishing is present your fly very gently and very naturally. If you slap it to the water, it's just going to scare fish. It's not going to be attractive to
them. That's not how flies land on the
water,
is it?
That's not how flies are supposed to land. They want to be gentle. A lot of people, when they first start trying to fly fish, they want to use a whole lot of arm. They want to push that line out themselves. When it is not your arm that's doing it, it's the rod. Okay, would you like to give it a try?
Okay.
Remember, keep your thumb pointed up. There you go. Keep your elbow down.
Okay.
And then just pick it up. Not too much wrist. Oh, that's not bad. You see what you did at the end?
No, I did. It called it.
You had a great pattern going, and then at the end you tried to
throw it out there.
You tried to throw it.
Okay.
And that last follow through, just let it keep going.
Okay.
Just kind of stop and then just let it keep going, and it'll probably go down very much more naturally. That's better. Elbows staying down. Not too much wrist. You want to use your forearm, not your wrist. Better. Much better.
Cool. Good. Simons, tell me about this line. I was noticing the color. Is that uniform or does it depend on conditions?
Oh, no. It really just depends on the manufacturer. The line color, they come in many different colors. You can get anything from a bright neon color, which is actually very easy for the angler to see, but sometimes that can be easier for the fish to see too, to more muted colors like this one. But the color itself really has nothing to do with its performance or its purpose. It's really just who makes it and how they market it.
Okay, so there's enough space between the fly and this part of the line to where
it usually is. That's
typically
what this leader
interfere
does.
With the
That's what this
fish.
Clearer line does. This is a leader,
mm-hmm.
and that's what you tie your fly to. And that clear part between it and the fly,
okay.
so that it's not very visible and it doesn't scare them away. A basic, good, all-around beginning rod, I would say, is an 8.5, 4 foot, or 9 foot, 5, 8.5, 4 weight, or a 9 foot, 5 weight, somewhere around there will take care of you just about anywhere in this area.
Mm-hmm. Well, I feel like I have just enough information and just enough experience to be really dangerous to anyone who's trying to fish around me. So what we have to do now is look at our calendars
figure
out when we can go to the river.
Find the date. We'll do it.
Sounds good.